Hi, welcome to the Downriver Council for the Arts. In this episode, you'll meet artists working with all different types of mediums, and you'll hear how we're bringing chamber music to the Downriver area. Come on in. Welcome to our artist interview series, where we feature an interview with one of our DCA member artists. Here you'll meet Ian, an illustrator from the Downriver area.
What inspired me to become an illustrator happened while I was at Cleveland Institute of Art, which is where I got my BFA. I went there thinking I was going to go through the game design program. I've been into video games pretty much my entire life. It's been a big influence on me. And freshman year at CIA is all foundational. And during that foundation year, you are expected to have little bits of pieces of each major that you're interested in. And during that year, I researched the game industry more, discovering that it has tumultuous at saying it nicely. And I decided to pivot towards illustration because that would allow me to work near that field and also explore other options that I was also interested in. My creative process is sort of stream of consciousness. I will take sketches, I will just start drawing. I have concepts sometimes in mind, but I will take those drawings that I either just finish in my sketchbook and will retranslate to a painting or another piece or pull ideas from those. I have a lot of different influences that will drive me to get into my sketchbook and think and learn and draw. But when it comes to making a finished piece, it's a 50-50 split of I just throw the canvas down in front of me and I start working at it and see what comes out, or I have a definitive idea that I have been working on for weeks or months at a time that I will then bring to a finished conclusion. My range of influences is quite broad. When I was in college, I was really drawn to the modern lowbrow scene or pop surrealism. The first big name I discovered on Instagram was Alex Pardee, who has done a lot of commercial work. He does a lot of lowbrow illustration, has done album artwork, does a lot of t-shirt design. That brought me down a huge Instagram rabbit hole of finding other artists of similar styles. I love Craig Gleason. I love Wizard of Barge. At the time, I was also, and still am, really into comic books. There was a DC series of Animal Man in the New 52. The illustrator on that book at the time was Travel Foreman, and his work was, as far as comics go, a little more surreal, a little more graphic, horror inspired. And I'm also lately drawn to a lot of, what's the word? I'm blanking. It's not surrealism. Well, I'm really drawn to lately Polish surrealism. One name that stands out that most people know that I'm going to butcher is Stanislaw Baksinski, who I think passed away in the 80s or 90s. His work is a clear influence on some game series that I am also interested in, where it's surreal horror, really conceptual, bleak, sort of landscape or creature design. And what I love about that work is it invokes concept and is a fine art approach. But in our modern era, where we see a lot of digital media, and like I keep saying, I'm interested and invested in video games, that translates over into the creatures or characters you interact with in those games. So My gamut is huge on what I look at and what inspires me to draw. Just the other day, I was listening to a band named Slug and decided I want to draw a slug. So sometimes it's as simple as that. Sometimes it's more conceptual. Could be from games, could be from comics, could just be from thoughts I've been having. It's a big range. I'm a firm believer that art should be for anyone and should be hung on everybody's wall. And that is part of what influenced me and my partner to start a printing company. When you think of fine art, you think of the painting in the gallery that costs $5,000, $1,500, you know, up and up and up and up. And what a lot of artists do that is both beneficial for them and for people who want to enjoy their art is make runs of prints, whether it's limited edition, G-Clays. I mean, you could do large volume. There's a lot of print on demand sites these days. It allows more people to engage with the work that they enjoy, and it gets more work to the average person who could not afford the original on their walls. And that is extremely important to me. I'm not trying to get rich off of what I make. I want to share what I make with others. And a lot of what I make, I would not say is on surface level serious. When we do art fairs in the summertime, what brings me the most joy is people pointing and getting a laugh or a positive reaction out of what they see, either on my prints or what it's on our table or whatever. So it's about joy and engagement and not taking yourself too seriously. And art is hard to make. And a lot of people either never tried or don't know much about it. But the more people who can have it on their walls at home, I think the better.
The Downriver Council for the Arts provides artists a unique retail space to sell one-of-a-kind handmade items. The gift shop at the Art Center is open year-round during normal hours and special events. If you're looking for that special gift, consider giving art. Meet Tricia, DCA member artist and also an instructor here at the Downriver Council for the Arts.
It's hard to pin down exactly what my style is because I don't only stick to one type of art. I'm always loving to learn, so I'll get interested in one type of media and then have some sort of ideas I want to follow through with. So I'm constantly learning. Sometimes I'm going far out into sculpture, other times in whimsical watercolor artwork, sometimes doing realistic color pencil portraits. I even jump around a little bit in themes, but one thing I've been told a lot about my artwork is that there's a lot of bright colors. Often when I'm ready to start a project, I have a plan. I know what I want to do, but that's not how it usually turns out. A lot of times I will have another idea along the way, another idea, and it always turns out something different than I planned. Often when I'm ready to start a project, I have a plan. I know what I want to do, but that's not how it usually turns out. A lot of times I will have another idea along the way, another idea, and it always turns out something different than I planned. Art has always been a passion of mine. I really love the concept of creating, being able to make anything that I want to make. If I could talk to my younger self, I would really just encourage myself to go for it. I remember being young and in college and just really, I remember having a lack of confidence, and I feel like that did bar me a bit. Maybe steered me a little bit away from being a full-time artist. Becoming a part of the DCA has been a huge blessing in my life and in my artistic career. I've been teaching here for I don't know how many years now. I'm always meeting new friends, new students, new artists that have really inspired me to go more different directions with my artwork.
In this video, you'll meet DCA resident artist Andy, who paints in a very rich texture.
Even when I was a kid, I mean, I wanted to, like, if my mom and dad went out and me and my sister were home at night, I would get out a pad and I would just start drawing and sitting there, and I could sit there and be happy for hours. So it was always kind of a peaceful thing for me. I always enjoyed doing it. And so there was no real particular reason other than I was attracted to it. And I remember one time they had these articles in the paper where you would fill out to be an artist, and all you did is you wrote this thing down, and you would send it in to see if you were an artist. They were going to tell you if you were an artist or not. I never got it back, so I don't think I'm really legitimately an artist, but that's how that worked out. Actually, there's hardly any strong intention behind my art other than a love to do it. So the love is my intention. I love color. And then on the same breath, I'm colorblind. But I see some colors. It's not like I'm totally, but the colors to me, like if you ever look at my work, some of my paint and my faces and stuff, they don't have flesh tones. I don't see that as far as when I do it. I see just colors of faces because to me, each face has an experience, an expression, something they had, a story behind their expression. And I've always been fascinated by that, and so, you know, some of my journey in the world of cancer and the world of things, I've saw some eyes and predicaments that always stayed with me, so I have a lot of work that does reflect that. Well, if I could go back in time, I would have the luxury to know that what truly brings joy in a life is not who you hang around with or who's your friends, it's how they make you feel when you're with them. And when I was with people in the band and people in theater and people with music and people that did art, I never felt better. But I fought that because it wasn't kind of cool. It wasn't cool. It just wasn't cool. I mean, you can play football, you can do this. So I would have opened up. And I did, but not as much now that I look back. If I was going to give up something, I would have gave up sports as I look back. And I would have embraced the arts, and I would have embraced, but you know, I'm not in regret, but that's what I would tell that younger self, to pay attention to the music, and because I loved it. It made me feel good. I loved being around people that were creative. I loved about people who would talk about things that weren't in books. It was just in thoughts and images and dreams and things like that. So that's what really intrigued me. The DCA was huge. I remember about 3 or 4 years ago, well, now it's 5 or 6 years ago, time flies. And I wanted to be here. I wanted to have a studio, but all the studios were taken. And I talked to Erin, she's very nice. And she, you know, she kept me in mind. So I was working in a condominium bathroom. I was doing my art in the bathroom because my wife had it with me, with being in the front room or in the kitchen. I'm kind of a hot mess when it comes to doing my art. It's physical for me. And so I was in the bathroom. So Erin calls me, I mean, just really, truly out of the blue. I hadn't talked with her in a long time. She says, there's a studio that's available, and I don't know who was more happier. I'm sure I was, but I know Nancy was really happy too. But that's how it began, and I started again rubbing up to people that are creative and people that like to talk about experience and try to put it on canvas or in music or in video or whatever, and I was right at home. I love this building, I really do. I think this building is just awesome, just awesome.
Each summer, we hold a chamber music series with the Chamber Artists of Southeast Michigan. Here, you'll listen to some of their concert, and hopefully next year, you'll be able to attend in person.
The Chamber Artists of Southeast Michigan, which is also called CASM for short. We have a lot of things that we do. We offer concerts here in partnership with the Downriver Council for the Arts. Every summer we try to give 3 concerts. We also are available for hire for all sorts of events and parties throughout the year as performers. And most recently we have gotten a scholarship initiative going, and our scholarship is open to Downriver High School students who are in instrumental music so that they can have a little bit of extra funds to help with instrument repair, summer festivals, marching band camp, all of that kind of thing.
Chasm Chamber Artist for Southeast Michigan is actually headed by my friend Brandon LePage. So I'm a guest artist on the concert today. Brandon runs and puts together these fantastic concerts every summer here at the Downriver Council for the Arts.
In this interview, we talked to Clifton, an abstract artist from Downriver.
My style of art is all abstract. I primarily utilize acrylic inks. And this is the main instrument that I use to create it. It's a dip pen. 1850s technology hasn't really changed since then. These are made in London, England, by a company that's, been making these forever. The predecessor of the ink pens were the quill pens our founding fathers used to sign the Declaration of Independence. I do augment some of my work with acrylic paints. Sometimes I use a dip pen to apply it. Occasionally I use various brushes and so forth. Sometimes even my fingers. It all depends on what the effect is that I want to create. What inspired me to embrace the art world is been drawing on and off all my life, reached my retirement years, and I just wasn't very happy. There was a void in my life that I needed to fill, and I realized that after so many years, decades actually, of drawing on and off, and how good I felt about it when I did do it, it would be a good thing for me to pursue. It seems like I appreciate taking something from each artist that I look at, each piece of work that I look at, and even looking back on my own work as I go along, I consider it all work in progress. So I learn something new with each piece I do and have ideas, and do I use it again, do I not, do I extrapolate it in some way? If you're going to be an artist, you got to live in a continuous learning environment and not be afraid to try things. The Downriver Council for the Arts is a fabulous resource. Certainly at artists in the community, but also artists everywhere, even outside of Detroit, outside of Michigan. You can get your artwork shown if you go through the procedure of responding to a call for entry. So DCA, as we call it, is a phenomenal resource. Certainly to the community. I think when you're talking a community, I think it's 21 separate cities. that collectively make up the Downriver, what we call in Detroit the Downriver community. And there's classes, tutorials, and opportunities for people of all skill levels. There's opportunity for people of all ages in a variety, unbelievable variety of media.
The Downriver Council for the Arts provides artists a unique retail space to sell one-of-a-kind handmade items. The gift shop at the Arts Center is open year-round during normal hours and special events. If you're looking for that special gift, consider giving art.
Hi, I'm Tim Porter, and I'm here at the Downriver Council for the Arts annual membership show. Every year we have a show that's focused only on the members of the DCA. We have a diverse group of members. Their artwork is extremely diverse, from sculpture to painting to beadwork to fiber work. The themes that they bring are landscape, portraiture, a multitude of different types of mediums and themes. It's a really good group, very friendly group. We love doing this show because everybody knows everybody else, and it's just a very, very nice community of artists, and they all work well together.
This is a painting of reflections. The building's reflecting itself on the water. The windows are reflecting themselves. And also the people that are in here are reflecting themselves. It's not usually what you think you look like, but it's a reflection of who you really are. And that's what this is about.
This is a pastel portrait I did in life drawing class, and it's done in pastels on colored paper, and I enjoy working with models because you can be more expressive and get your feelings across with the piece. You can get the personality is what I feel when I sketch the a model. And I usually work in pastels and try to portray that image to the viewer.
So I'm always on the lookout for subjects that inspire me to paint. And one thing I found particularly interesting are these bonsai trees. Now, bonsai are crafted by artists themselves, and it's a living art where they take little trees and they'll nurture them sometimes for years to produce these fantastic specimens. The one on the top is what's called a Korean hornbeam tree. Korean hornbeam. And I painted that one in plein air, which means I went out and sat in the open and painted it over a couple of hours. The lower one is a Suzuki azalea bonsai tree. And this particular tree I painted in my studio, and it's just so magnificent. It took quite a bit to get the colors correct, but I'm happy with it.
This is called Life's a Maze, and this and the series that it's a part of is inspired by something my favorite teacher probably ever told me. What she said was, she was comparing me to her son, and she said, "You guys are a lot alike. It's like, because you're always focused on like the big picture, like the scary stuff happening in the world." And she said, meanwhile, I, on the other hand, referring to herself, she said, "I'm always just focused on like this, I'm just wandering around looking at this little flower here on the ground." And The thing was, I was having not a very great day, and her kind of explaining that to me just made my day and made me realize that, yeah, I really do have to focus more on like the little, small, beautiful flowers in life, and this is kind of what that series is about.
Well, this painting, I started doing a series with small dots, and I always liked the idea of the connections that bridges portray, kind of bridging between people or invitation to people. With this particular painting, I was kind of thinking especially of immigrants and coming to this country and what they have to cross in the waters. And the waters are huge, but they're very friendly because of the colors that I used. And the idea of the sunset or sunrise, I see as very hopeful and as something bright. And yet the whole universe is kind of in there with a moon and lights on the bridge. And I hope it's a very friendly and hopeful image for people to see. And kind of a Michigan image. This painting is another one of my ones that I started with dots, but the dots got larger, and I called it Descent. It's just a very powerful movement with this red ball coming down and slicing through things. It was just a dynamic image for me. And I had a lot of fun doing it.
Okay, well, this particular piece, I was really having some fun. It's an acrylic piece, but I was having a lot of fun putting it together. And in this sense, the dog, this little hound, went and got the owner and he said, "Look, the cat is going after the goldfish." Now the owner has come, and the title is "Don't Even Think About It." That's why you have the finger here. He's chastising the cat. And I know it's a little garish, you know, it's quite garish and colorful, but I think that's what I wanted to do. I just wanted to have some fun with it. And I used my own hands as a model, my watch. And that was kind of fun putting the clock in there as well, you know. But that was one of the first pieces I've done in many years. So I enjoy doing that.
This is my photograph. It's of an abandoned COVID testing site in Detroit. It was in the parking lot of a community center is where this site was. And this was last summer. I was at the grocery store next door and I noticed it, and it was just kind of in shambles because they were no longer using it for COVID testing, which I thought was a real sign of the times that we've kind of moved to the next phase of the pandemic. And I just thought it was really a good moment to capture. So if you go by there now to the same parking lot, it's just a regular parking lot. They've now removed all of the COVID signage and cones and everything that were up all over the place. But.
I think that this exhibit is really exciting, and it's cool to see that there's so much local talent in the area. There's just so many different mediums and different styles, so it's really cool to see all of it put together.
Hello, this is my bird bath that I made. I've been making bird baths for 25 years on and off. This one here is a little different design, kind of an Art Nouveau. Name of the piece is 16. The reason I 16 because it starts off with 4, then 8, and then 16 branches, 16 flowers, 16 little curlicues, and it's all copper. They last for centuries. There's a turtle down here and a dragonfly there, and that's it.